Praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to our Tuesday night teaching. This is our regular weekly Bible study. We're so grateful and thankful to have you sharing this time with us. Those who are watching on YouTube, perhaps Facebook, or even Twitter, I would encourage you to share this post. Invite others to come and be a part of this. I'm so excited about this series that we've kicked off the new year with. It's entitled Back to Basics, Essential Components of Christian Life. This is something the Lord really pressed on my heart as I was praying towards the end of last year and thinking about where we wanted to go this year, particularly in the way of teaching. And this study, of course, is informed by two books, one of which is called On Being Christian, written by Rowan Williamson. And it is a shorter read, or Rowan Williams, should I say. It's a shorter read. And the other book that we'll be kind of moving into over the next couple of weeks is a book entitled The Celebration of Discipline, written by Richard Foster. And in that book, of course, he talks about have been some of the traditional and essential practices of Christians over the years, the spiritual practices. The first couple of weeks, we want to talk about more so the components of Christian life. When somebody says to you, or you say to someone, like, I am a Christian, what does that mean? Certainly, it doesn't simply mean that you go to church, because, you know, everybody who goes to a church doesn't even necessarily identify as being Christian. So what does it mean when we say that we are Christians? What are some of those components of Christian life? And of course, we've already talked about baptism. The church is a group of baptized believers. Remember, your baptism was the first week. Then we talked also about the Bible, this collection of 66 books that we ascribe to as being inspired by God, God-breathed, useful for teaching, reproach, instruction, correction, this collection of books that we believe to be the infallible Word of God. I won't get into a conversation about inerrancy, but the infallible Word of God that speaks to us even today. And then tonight, we're going to be talking some. I really started and set out to have a conversation about communion and the Eucharist, which we will unpack. But one of the things I feel like is hard to do, if not impossible, is to talk about communion without having a conversation simply about hospitality and what it means to share meals with other persons in the biblical context and even today. So for that reason, we're going to be breaking up tonight really into two parts. But our subject tonight is Let Us Break Bread Together. I do want to say this too while it's on my mind. All right, so in this study, we've been talking about the components of Christian life, and soon we're going to be moving into some of the central practices, spiritual disciplines, the inner disciplines, the outer disciplines, and then also what Richard Foster refers to as the corporate disciplines. This year is, of course, a leap year. Easter comes early. Easter is the fifth Sunday in March. I believe it's March 31st. Consequently, we're not too far out from Ash Wednesday. And Ash Wednesday this year is February the 14th, my son Kylan's birthday, Valentine's Day. You can mark your calendars. We will have an Ash Wednesday service here that week at 12 noon. I'll probably try to get to the church as early as I can. I'll try to be here close to 9, but from 9 all the way to we have the service. Ash Wednesday, of course, marks the beginning of the season of Lent. Those 7 weeks that lead us up to Easter, and not counting the Sundays. And of course, that is a time of more intense spiritual practices, such as praying, fasting, giving, worshiping, and many of us will engage in the Lenten fast. Ash Wednesday is what kicks that off. So that will be here soon, but this study will overlap some with the season of Lent. And hopefully you're praying and thinking about that even now, because that's where we are on the Christian calendar. But tonight, again, we are talking about let us break bread together. The words of that hymn come to my mind. Let us break bread together on our knees. So I want to anchor our conversation tonight from a passage in the book of Revelation, no S, Revelation, chapter 3, verse number 20. As we talk about, let us break bread together. Let's have a word of prayer before we go further. Lord, we thank you for this time, this hour, to listen and learn more about your word. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but your word shall not pass away. The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God shall remain forever. And Lord, this word is our guiding book. This word is one of the ways that you are speaking to us even now. This word is not only has power to change our minds, but to work on our hearts. And so, Lord, we ask that your word, the seeds of your word, might find fertile ground tonight and bear fruit 30, 60, even 100-fold. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. A scripture I do want to just pull, and it's really from out of context, but I just want to read it to anchor this conversation tonight. Jesus says in Revelation 3 and 20, listen, I'm standing at the door knocking. If you will hear my voice and open the door, I'll come in and eat with you and you with me. All right. So I want to start tonight. We're talking about, and we're going to really be talking about hospitality, but this whole idea of communion. There are two ordinances in the Baptist church, of course, the first being water baptism. Talked about that a few weeks ago, where and it happens at the beginning of a person's faith walk. You are submerged into the waters, as we practice in our tradition. And what that typifies is us being dying to one way of life and being raised to a new. And so that's one ordinance of the Baptist church. The other one, of course, is communion, which you're also going to hear me refer to tonight as Eucharist, because that, of course, is the oldest name for this practice is Eucharist, and it refers to the Christian sacrament, also known as Holy Communion or the Lord's Supper. Now, let me also make this distinction and nuance this some as it relates to we're referring to this as the Lord's Supper, not the Last Supper. The Last Supper happened already. But when we gather to reenact this scene from the Last Supper, we're calling that the Lord's Supper. Or just in case Talia is watching tonight and some other Catholics, it's also referred to as Mass. All right, that's for you. All right, so for us to share in this meal is to live as people who are mindful of the fact that always when it comes to our relationship and fellowship with God, we are invited guests. We are people who have not only been welcomed by God, but we are people who are wanted by God. Some time ago, I read a book, and I think it was called Evangelism with No Additives. And it was powerful because what it was talking about, it didn't refer to people who don't know Christ as the lost. It referred to them as people who Jesus misses the most. Because here's the reality of it. And we get a good picture of this in Luke 15, parable of the lost sheep, the lost coin, and the lost son. God desires to be in relationship with us. God wants to spend time with us. Think about that. God eagerly wants to spend time with us. You know, there's a difference with you spending time with folk you don't want to spend time with versus those you deeply desire to spend time with. When you're in the company of people you don't especially want to spend time with, it can be kind of painful. You know, minutes can feel like hours. You can drift off to sleep mid-conversation. I mean, it's not a lot of joy in that. But it's so different when you really, really, really want to spend time with someone. Now, I think about, I used to be as a young boy, how excited I was because my dad used to work. Who's retired now. Congratulations. Shout out to my namesake. I'm trying to get to where you are. But my dad is retired recently, and I'm happy he's retired. But my dad, for the earlier part of my years, they were in business for themselves. My dad was a logger. Working out in the woods in terms of cutting down trees and running that large equipment and, you know, taking trees to Weyerhaeuser and other places. And so you know, so he would be gone like 5 in the morning, oh, dark 30, my dad would leave and wouldn't get home until the evening. And, you know, I just used to want to spend time with him. I was anxious kind of about him coming home. So I had become attuned to the sound of his truck pulling in the yard. And, you know, Lynn, my dad, sometimes I didn't understand it then. Like, he would just sit in the truck for a while before he came in. But I'm sitting there like, oh, I can't wait for him to come in the house. And I get that now because I have children myself. You know, you don't always just come home and just run in the house. So, like, you got the kind of, you got the woosah and gird up your loins before you go in the house. But I wanted to spend time with him. So I would be eager and excited about that. I know even on some Saturdays, my dad would have different things going on and maybe going to pawn shops, doing different. It didn't matter to me. Wherever you're going, I wanted to go. I'm saying that to say that God wants to spend time with us. And that is an amazing idea if you really think about it. Hear what Jesus says in Revelation 3:20. Behold, I stand at the door knocking. If you hear my voice, open the door. I'll come in and eat with you and you with me. And this is perhaps the most simple thing we can say about Holy Communion, yet is still worth saying. In Holy Communion, Jesus Christ tells us that he wants our company. And if you think about it, the Last Supper, and we'll lift up what those scriptures are, because we find an account of this in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Even Judas was at the table. And Jesus did not discriminate when it came to him taking bread or wine and sharing. Jesus did not discriminate, if you look at John's account, when it comes to this idea that Jesus washed the disciples' feet as well. All right, so Jesus, and these are words from Rowan Williams, I found powerful. It says, Jesus is not only someone who exercises hospitality, but he draws hospitality from others. By his welcome, he makes other people capable of welcoming. He gave hospitality, but then also he received it. And this shows us something very essential about the Eucharist. We are guests of Jesus. His welcome gives us the courage to open up to him. So when it is we come to the table, and the Bible tells us we should examine ourselves, that ought to be a deep moment of reflection and recognition of this reality that, you know, we come to the table not because we must, but because we may. We are invited. We are wanted at the Lord's table. So hospitality is something Jesus gave, but it's also something he receives. And here's something else it shows us again about Eucharist, that we are guests of Jesus. His welcome gives us the courage to open up to him. The meals that Jesus shared in his ministry are how he begins to recreate community, to lay the foundation for rethinking what it means for us to say that we are people of God. And again, we got to have not just conversation about communion, but a broader conversation about, if you read the Gospels, think about how much stuff Jesus said around the table. And think about how much even of his miracles involved food. The only miracle performed by Jesus recorded in all four of the Gospels is Jesus doing what? Feeding a multitude, 2 fish, 5 loaves of bread. And even those words, as we can reflect on them, echo the same thing Jesus would say at the Last Supper, right? So when he made them sit down in green pastures, if you think about him feeding the multitude, and then he took bread, blessed it, broke it, took the fish, you know, he gave thanks and he distributed. So very, 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 very similar to what we read and what we see at the Last Supper. So sharing meals, that quality time, it really mattered to Jesus. Consequently, it should matter to us. The sharing communion is to experience once again Christ's call to a new level of life together, a new fellowship and solidarity, and a new willingness and capacity to be welcomers of other people. So we've been welcomed to the table by God, and then of course we are to welcome others as well. All right, so it's important to note that. Let me say something else. Jesus was so welcoming, Jesus was so hospitable, that he often got himself into trouble. Again, look at Luke 15, and this is the impetus, if you would, for Jesus giving those three parables about the lost and the found. It says that tax collectors and others took issue with the fact that Jesus welcomed sinners and that he ate with them, right? So because in antiquity, particularly in the biblical times, to eat with someone was to also imply that you were accepting of them. And so Jesus, who says somewhere else in the gospel, that it's not those who are well, but it's the sick who need a physician. Some of the religious folk took issue with the fact that Jesus welcomed sinners and that Jesus ate with them. But this is where I contend Jesus had a much different paradigm than even the modern church today. You know, we want people, hear this, to behave and to believe before they become. But Jesus allowed people to become and welcome them even before they believed and really learned how to behave. And so think about this, you know, some of those despised persons in Jesus' day, Zacchaeus, tax collector, when he climbs up the tree, sycamore tree, trying to just get a glimpse of Jesus. What did Jesus say? Zacchaeus, come down, for today I must eat in your house. Even before Zacchaeus believed, even before Zacchaeus really learned how to behave, Jesus permitted him to belong. And again, this is where I think sometimes in the church, you know, we are more inclined to do the reverse. We want people to believe like us and behave like us. Then you really become a part of us. We permit you to belong. But Jesus allowed people to belong. And here's the thing, maybe if we learned how to practice and exercise hospitality and really allow people to belong first, they might learn how to believe and how to behave. All right, so that's just a thought I have about that. But two books, and I think, Lynn, I told you about this. I read two books. One I read by mistake because somebody recommended a book to me. I realized this ain't what they were talking about, but I read it anyway. And then another book was interesting. Both of these books deal with this idea of hospitality. The one I read by mistake, which, you know, maybe you can pick up if you want to think more intentionally about. It's called Extraordinary Hospitality, and it's written by a lady named Carolyn Lacey. In this book, she explores how to practice Christian hospitality without feeling overwhelmed or burned, slap, slam out. Of course, these are my words, not hers, but the faithful to what she's talking about. She argues that being generously hospitable is a significant way through which God works in our lives to bring life to others. And I believe that. I really believe that as, you know, when you say, Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary and to be a vessel, the Lord will use you oftentimes to be the answer to someone else's prayers. The Lord works in our lives, oftentimes through hospitality, to bring life then to others. All right. But the book I'm currently reading, which is not, you know, necessarily a Christian book, it's entitled Unreasonable Hospitality. And it's by somebody named Will Gadara. And it's written for people in the hospitality business. But despite that fact, I think it really does offer some insights for how churches should operate. Gadara suggests that we can turn ordinary transactions. And again, this is somebody who works in the hospitality industry. He took a 2-star restaurant and turned it into one of the most, you know, top 50 dining facilities in the world. He's a second or third generation person in this industry. So he writes this book. But I think some of the things he's talking about is true for the church as well. He suggests that we can turn ordinary transactions into extraordinary experiences through hospitality. Let me say that again. We can turn ordinary transactions into extraordinary experiences through hospitality, which according to him, means giving people more than they expected. That's how he defines that. You can turn an ordinary transaction into an extraordinary experience through hospitality. he defines as giving people more than they expected. Now, that's a tall order for the large church. I mean, it's a great business practice, and I think it's something the church needs to aspire to, but it's a tall order because, you know, everybody's expectations are not reasonable or realistic, but there's still some things in here that we need to consider. So this aligns, I contend, with the way Jesus operated. Is that not what Jesus did? Gave people more oftentimes than what they expected, right? Notice when he fed the multitude, did they not have more fish and bread left over than what they started with? Jesus was giving them more than what they expected. And also Jesus gave folk more than oftentimes than what they asked for. He gave them what they needed, right? So, and again, there are so many biblical witnesses that speak to this point, but I really want to get, I want to go a little bit further. Here's something else he says in this book that I found striking, and I want my staff persons to really think about this, all y'all here watching. I want y'all to think about this. He says, service is black and white, but hospitality is color. Service is black and white, but hospitality is color. So black and white refers to doing your job competently and efficiently, right? That's the black and white piece of service. While color means making people feel great about the job you're doing for them. And I want us to think about that. You know, one major component of our ministry here is our food pantry. And we, you know, we refer to those who we're serving as customers, right? Because we are here to serve them. And one of the things I hope that people experience through this ministry, because, you know, it's not that you're just kind of coming to the church and getting some handout and you should be grateful we gave you whatever. But I want you to feel loved and cared for because, again, an ordinary transaction can become an extraordinary experience through hospitality. And so, you know, I think it's important for us that, you know, we want to make the people we're trying to serve feel great about what we're doing for them. That's a high bar, but I think it's something we should aspire to. Even when it comes to us giving things and offering things, we all, people ought to feel good about what we're doing for them. Now, this is my central argument for tonight as it relates to hospitality. And we're going to put this up on the screen. These are my words, my thoughts, and I'll make some points based on this. Let me say this. You don't have to be Christian to be hospitable. Many of y'all, you've lived long enough to meet some incredible people who were not even saved, right? That's why I never understood, you know, why people will say, this is just an asinine comment to me. You know, sometimes people say like, you know, well, I'm gonna speak to you and I don't like it, but I'm gonna speak to you anyway because I ain't trying to go to hell. I'm like, man, you need Jesus to speak to somebody? You're like, you know what I mean? Like, you know, I mean, you know, you need Jesus for that? you need the specter of eternal damnation to go say hello to somebody? My God, you know, when it comes to hospitality, you don't have to be Christian to be hospitable. But I would say this too, conversely, that if you want to be a good Christian, being hospitable is crucial. Sit with that. You do not have to be Christian to be hospitable, to be kind. That's just called adulting. But if you want to be a good Christian, being hospitable is crucial. Because this is what I'm thinking about, y'all. As I've been praying and I was thinking about some of the things that Jesus did for people, and I know the Bible only says what it says, but we just can't imagine that Jesus performed miracles in a mean and antagonistic kind of way, right? You just can't imagine that, you know, when Jesus says to the woman who was caught in the very act of adultery, he says, you know, where are your accusers? If they don't condemn you, neither do I. You just can't imagine that he said that with a cantankerous tone. You know, when Jesus fed the multitude and they were distributing bread and fish, I just can't imagine that Jesus gave it to them with this attitude of, you know, you ought to be grateful I gave you anything. Next time, bring your own food. So, you know, when Jesus did these things, you know, when he touched lepers, who were untouchable, when he permitted himself to be touched by the woman with the issue of blood, when he spoke to Jairus's daughter, who was dead, except a little girl. You know, I mean, you just got to imagine that Jesus did that with a tender tone, and that Jesus did it with a spirit of compassion, kindness, of love, and there, I want to say, hospitality. So again, if you remember nothing else I say tonight, here's my point. You don't have to be Christian to be hospitable, but if you want to be a good Christian, being hospitable is crucial. All right, so allow me to make 6 points here tonight, and then that will be our time together. Here's the first thing I want to say about hospitality. The Bible says so. Let me start right there. The Bible. You know, I say, Jesus loved me this, I know, for the Bible says so. All right, well, quit being thorny and cantankerous. Be hospitable. Why? Because the Bible says so. Hebrews chapter 13 and 2. Now, I referenced this yesterday in my sermon, where it says, do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, right? Because here's the thing about, and you know, this goes back to my sermon yesterday. We were talking about the type of ecology that seeds can thrive in, particularly in Jesus' parable. This was about grain. And, you know, it says that there were some of the seed fell among thorn bushes. But eventually the thorn bushes grew so rigorously that it choked out the small grain plants, and they yielded no grain. And you know, one of the things we talked about is that there are some vigorous types of plant life and small creepy things that can survive with thorns. And in fact, thorns can be the best friend of some types of plants and even small creepy things, right? Because, you know, there were seeds that fell out on a path where the birds just came and ate them up, right? Well, so there were also seeds that fell among thorn bushes. The bird's not going to come down there and just eat those. So, you know, the thorn bushes can be friendly towards insiders, right? But the problem is, this kind of ecology does not permit a seed of grain to yield a harvest. And Jesus' parable is about grain. Grain is what's needed for bread, you know, and bread is what's needed for life and for sustainability, right? You know, all kind of problems arise when you start talking about food deserts and food insecurity. So that's a really, really profound point, because here's the thing, if I could bring back to the church, every church thinks they're friendly. There's no church that touts themselves as being a mean church. But you know, there's some church that are mean. And I think what's kind of going on is that, okay, you are friendly towards each other. But, you know, the litmus test of your hospitality, your kindness, and not necessarily how you treat others, you know, heck, you know, these churches like, that's your mama. Of course you ain't gonna come at her wrong, right? I mean, like, you know, we're very friendly here. Well, you ain't got no choice, because your mama will slap you, all right? But, you know, how do we treat those then who are perceived and considered outsiders? So when we think about seed that fell among the thorn bushes, obviously there would have been vigorous plant life that would have grown, and there would have been little creepy things that would have been okay, but that kind of ecology is not conducive or friendly towards outsiders, and such is the case in many of our churches. So if we're going to take seriously the call to do what the Bible says do, and be hospitable and be kind, right, then we have to hear afresh these words of the writer of Hebrews chapter 13 and verse number 2. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by so doing, people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. And so, and you know, I'm not here to exegete this particular passage tonight, but when you think about it, like the writer is very much referring to concrete instances, even in the Bible. You know, this is not just some, you know, perhaps, like, no, in Genesis, other places of the Bible, people absolutely were entertaining strangers and showing kindness, did not even realize it. All right, so again, this reflects the idea that by welcoming others, we may be unknowingly extending kindness to those in need. Because here's the thing about hospitality, and even the smallest acts really matter. You just don't know how bad and desperately somebody needed that hug, that smile, that, you know, ever so small gift of kindness. That's why, you know, when I'm moving about just in life, you know, I just try to, you know, just, you know, be mindful of kind of what's going on around me. You know, you're in a grocery store, you see somebody differently abled, you know, struggling, help them, right? You know, I mean, it's just so many opportunities we're given on a day in and a day out basis to just extend kindness to folk, and we ought to take advantage of it. Number one, because the Bible says so. All right? So that's for my folk who can't do nothing unless the Bible says so. Do it because the Bible says so. That's number one. All right. Here's number two. This is a way of how we imitate, and dare I say, emulate Jesus Christ. Okay? Because when we're talking about discipleship, we're talking about what it means to follow Jesus. You know, we're not called simply to admire Jesus, but our call is to be like Jesus. We should, and by that, what I mean is, and Paul even talks about this, you all follow me as I follow Christ. Okay, so we have an opportunity to imitate Christ. Christians are called to imitate the example of Jesus Christ. Jesus frequently engaged in table fellowship. Frequently engaged in table fellowship, welcoming, again, not just insiders. That's what I need you to understand. Jesus welcomed and ate with not just those in his quality circle, but Jesus ate with, and dare I say, welcomed sinners and those who were considered outcast in that particular day. And you can mull over and pray and think about, you know, who might be some of those folk today. Not just so much sinners, right? Because I think we all are in that category, right? You know, we may be a saint, but we got sinner problems. But, you know, who are considered, and for different reasons, maybe some of the outcast, you know, and it's something we have an opportunity to, again, put into practice. It's a way of how we can imitate Christ. Here's number three. It's also how we strengthen bonds and build community. It's how we strengthen bonds and build community. I feel like this just doesn't need an explanation. Hospitality fosters a sense of community and fellowship among believers. Sharing meals and opening homes creates opportunities for deeper relationships and mutual support within the church community. You know, one of the things I understand as a pastor, we were talking about this just this past Sunday, how, you know, there was some of us who were here, you know, probably an hour after church, just, you know, talking among ourselves, reflecting on the weekend and what, and, you know, the one of the points I made is, was one of the points that somebody else made is, you know, it's funny. They were like, in the business world, they talk about how, you know, the deals really get done on the golf course and such. Well, in the church, it seems like some of the business really gets done, you know, after church. And, you know, the point I made and the thing my response to that was because, you know, while we've been engaged in worship, you know, much of the, you know, we're kind of just talking to people and sharing and offering and, you know, it's kind of one-sided, right, in a real sense. Well, after church, there's somebody who came who has something that they want to say to me, you know, or want to say to another church leader or say to somebody else. There's some folk who have concerns, and they came not only to hear what you got to say, but they came and they needed a space to be heard. And so how then do we create those kind of spaces and opportunity? Because, again, there are persons who, again, not only want to hear from me per se, but also people who need to be heard. And I get that. And dare I say, I even affirm that. So we have to be intentional about it. We have to do something beyond just, you know, church in the sanctuary, right? If we're going to strengthen bonds and really build community, really get to know who is that person that we often sit together and exchange pleasantries, but I could not tell you one thing about them. You know, how many times do we have to come to church? How many times you got to be around somebody before, you know, you kind of try to engage them on a more deeper level? And so, you know, hospitality is the order of the day. But one of the ways that I think to be biblical that Jesus would have done that is by sharing a meal. One of the things we've done, and I have to credit our executive director of operations right here to help make some of this happen is, you know, we try to have a good number of just fellowships and time of just, you know, being with one another, not just working, but listening to one another, talking with one another, checking in with one another. You know, there are some, you know, one critique and indictment of the church that I think is weak and watered down and not well-founded is when, you know, you talk about this church, well, you know, all y'all do is just get together and eat. We're just wasting money. How would they just get there to eat? Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. There's value in that. You know, last I checked, you needed food to live. You know, I can do a lot of stuff and not live. So again, food is important. And you know, for me, it's just the whole theology. And I don't have time to get into this tonight, but there are quite literally, and science proves this, there are things such as called food memories, right? Where you can literally, there are certain foods you can eat, certain places you can be that will conjure up for you certain memories and take you back to a different place, right? So, you know, so for me, it's my grandmother, my dad's mother, and she's been a little sick, but she's getting better. Thank you for your prayers. You know, one of the things, man, I love to do with her is, you know, when I have time and go home, is like to just go to her house and eat stewed potatoes and fish. Nobody makes it quite like her. And it's just like, you know, and trust me, I'm a foodie. I've eaten a lot of places, spent a lot more money than I embarrassed by how much money I spend on food at times. But, you know, there's nothing quite like just sitting at my grandma's table, you know, just eating stewed potatoes and fish, because it takes me back, right, to think about even my childhood and some of the people who would be at the table, who are no longer there. It's just, you know, and it's so food memories are a real thing, and it's something we just ought not take lightly. And I think we also should not uncritically just dismiss the idea of church, y'all just eating too much. No, there's something to be said about sharing in that regard. Number four, again, hospitality, church, it's just a way to show love, right? Love is a verb. Love is what love does. When God got ready to prove God's love to us, God became the Word made flesh. And we too are embodied beings. And y'all know I'm always sounding alarm on that. Like sometimes folk need something more than just your thoughts and the positive vibes and positive energy. Sometimes real love is just showing up for folk. It's about what you do. You know, don't tell me, you know, I'm there for you, you know, in the spirit. You ain't go to court in the spirit. Amen, somebody. You know, we have some members of our church who work, and I'm not gonna call names, but who work for some of our professional sports teams in Charlotte, and they've been encouraging people, you know, you need to come to Reader, you need to come to beat the Reader. And one multimillionaire, well-known athlete in our city here, Charlotte, will say, you know, I watch online, and I said, well, you tell me, you ain't go to court online. You know, you went in person, we read it. Right? So, I mean, like, you know, I don't know how I got on that, but let me come back. Love is what love does. Hospitality is the tangible way, tangible somebody, of expressing love and compassion by opening one's home and your heart to other Christians. It demonstrates selfless love that is centered on faith. Because here's the thing about even doing good works, acts of kindness. Jesus talks about don't just do it for people and don't just give to folk who you know are going to pay you back, right? But you ought to share with those who can't, and God will reward you in heaven. That's number five. Hospitality is an avenue for ministry. And I think I've been making that point all along, but more specifically for evangelism and edification. Hospitality is an avenue for ministry. Hospitality is an avenue for the work of the Lord. By welcoming, look, not just saints, but sinners, not just believers, but non-believers into the community of faith, Christians create opportunities to share the gospel and to demonstrate the transformative power of God's love. Because here's the thing, there are some folk who will not meet you at Reader at the communion table, but they might meet you at some restaurant at that table. And if you are hospitable and kind towards them there, don't you know that's an avenue? if you handle that table right, you know, before you know it, you might see them at a different table. Amen, somebody. Here's number six. It is a way of caring for those in need. Hospitality. Is that not what the Bible tells us to do? This aligns with what Christians are, dare I say, called to do, which is serve the less fortunate. As is mentioned in Matthew 25, verses 35 through 36, for I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me. When did I do this? When did these things happen? And as much as you did unto the least of these, Jesus says, so you did it unto me. And so the act of sharing meals holds symbolic significance in Christianity, particularly in the context of the Lord's Supper. Communion emphasizes unity, equality, and the remembrance of Christ's sacrifice, reinforcing the importance of hospitality. So I'm going to end there, but next week, you know, having laid this groundwork and talking about the need, and dare I say the call, and the necessity of just hospitality, we'll focus in some and go into communion on next week. You don't have to be Christian to be hospitable, but in order to be a good Christian, hospitality is an absolute necessity. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be unto God. Hey, I appreciate you for sharing this time with us on tonight. Let us get excited and let us anticipate those things that are forthcoming here in our church. Obviously, this coming Sunday, we're going to start selling tickets for the opportunity to go see the play. Our church is Reserve Theater Charlotte. I'm sending out an email about this. It's also an electronic bulletin to go see the play Mountaintop on February the 24th, which is a Saturday. But we got all the tickets, but they're still limited. So we have 75. We'll start selling those this Sunday, and they are $20 a piece. Also, please reach out to us this Sunday. If you're not going to be here Sunday or can't get a Sunday, reach out to the office, secure your ticket. We look forward to this opportunity for a fellowship on the 24th. And then we're going to couple that on the 26th with a conversation and a forum here at the church with several of the actors, as well as our church member who's directing the play, Dr. Corliss Hayes. So we're excited about that. Also, be mindful on the first Sunday of February, Communion Sunday, at the service, we'll be having a ministry fair. Some of y'all have been praying and thinking about, how can I get more involved? How can I contribute more, do more? This is going to be a great opportunity. We'll have 25 or so ministries present here and represented, and you'll have an opportunity to get questions answered, to get clarity, to figure out whether or not this is a ministry that you could get involved with and what you can contribute. So it's going to be an amazing opportunity. Plus, we'll have light refreshments for you. Food, that is, that we're going to have light refreshments on the first Sunday. So, hey, look, it's a great time to be saved. It's a great time to be alive. It's a great time to be a member of Reno Memorial Baptist Church. Please prayerfully consider how you can also give. Giving is something else. You ain't got to be saved to give. You don't even have to love to give. But if you really do love, then you're going to give. If you are redeemed and saved, and you've been welcomed by God, and you've been blessed by God, you know the importance of being a blessing as well. So if you want to contribute to this ministry, you can do so here the ways on the screen. Pause it if you need to go get your purse and go find your EBT card or whatever you're using. I don't think we take EBT card, but you know, whatever you need, your Green Dot card, your Visa, whatever. The information is there. You visit readerministries.org/give. Text them on your screen, fill out the simple prompt, and any way you choose to be a blessing to this ministry, we will be most appreciative. Thank you so much for being with us. Come back next week for part two as we go further in this discussion. Let us break bread together. Pray with me if you would. Gracious God, we thank you for this time that's been ours to listen and learn more about your word. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but your word shall not pass away. Hide your word in our hearts that we, God, might not mistrust you. Help us, God, to hold on to your word when trouble comes, when trials come. Lord, work on our hearts. Allow us to be fertile ground for receiving and accepting your word. We know, God, that biblically we can't just be hearers, but we also have to heed the word. So, God, we are here tonight, not just to gather up more Jesus facts, not just to know better, but help us, God, to do better. Take advantage of opportunities we have to be hospitable and show kindness to other people and to imitate Jesus Christ in this regard. And we pray this prayer in the name of Jesus. Thank you again, God, for all your goodness and your blessings towards us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen and amen. We out. Hit the music.